Welcome to Questions for Christians, a TV show where I, as an atheist, talk to different Christians about interesting topics and try to have a friendly discussion. My guest today is Robert Baty. I ran across him on the internet a while back, maybe a year ago, and we haven't really addressed this, but he's got a challenge out for atheists, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. First, I'm going to give a short overview of who I am, and then Robert can give a short overview of who he is. Myself, I was raised a Roman Catholic. After college in 1984, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. I got a bachelor's in science of electronics, engineering, technology, and worked in the computer field. And while I was doing that, I got a master's in ministry degree because I was growing as an evangelical Christian. I got my master's in ministry degree in 2007, and in 2009, I became an atheist because I debated with atheists, and I think their worldview makes more sense of the world. So I was a Christian until age 49. I wrote a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology just to remind myself why I left the faith, because I do believe that Christian theology can no longer survive in modern science and philosophy. And I talk to a lot of Christians. I do a lot of debates locally, many, many debates over the years. And I post those online so people can learn from it, and hopefully for those who are seeking, they can learn something new and make their own decision about what they believe is the best belief system. My YouTube channel is called Sec Hummer, short for Secular Humanist. So that's a brief overview for me. Robert Baty, welcome to the show. Can you give maybe a one-minute overview as what your background is, and then we'll get into the topic?
Okay. I'm currently 66 years old. I've been a Christian a long, long time. Member of the Church of Christ. And one of the well-known historical figures associated with the Church of Christ in America was Alexander Campbell back in the 1800s. And he was famous in part for his public debates, one of which was with the skeptic Robert Owen in 1829, where they discussed their various worldviews and other things. And that debate's still available online and in book form, I believe. And one of the things that impressed me about that debate, as I observed the popular debate in modern times, is that Campbell confronted Owen with the question as to where the origin of the idea of God came from.
Are we getting into the topic now, or are you still doing your background description?
Oh, yeah, I guess I was getting into the topic a bit. I gave my background. I'm an old Christian, 66 years old, and a casual observer as to the atheist-theist debate. I try to, in my approach to it, having been enticed in the public square and knowing my own limitations somewhat, try to keep things simple. And that's my background. And
okay.
So I was taking off into my exercise.
Okay, so to introduce our topic, I think the way you advertise it is you have six questions for atheists. And they're kind of sequential, is that right?
Right. There is a rationale to the sequence of the questions. And it's not just for atheists. It's labeled as a critical thinking exercise. Anybody can take it successfully. And it happens to deal with the subject of atheism, which speaks for itself, I guess.
Is it supposed to lead to the conclusion that atheism is a bad idea?
No, I would say that what it does, I think, fundamentally, is reduced to a fundamental level a basic atheist claim and show that when you put it in a logically valid form, even atheists can see the problem with it.
Okay, so why don't we step through it and get started, and I'll let you take the driver's chair and ask the questions and see where we go.
Okay.
I think I kind of glanced over the questions, but I didn't spend much time on it, so it's kind of new for me. So we'll see what happens.
Okay. Let me present the argument in reverse order, based on how it was developed. Some atheists claim that the idea of God originated as a result of imagination, man's ability to just dream up the idea.
I believe that.
Okay. As I was mentioning earlier, the question Campbell posed to Owen in 1829 was it from reason, revelation, or imagination? And Owen jumped on imagination, obviously.
Obviously, it can't be revelation because there's no God to reveal it.
Right. That's the atheist argument. The bolder atheist.
There is some reason to it, though. I mean, there's a reason why people believe in supernatural characters is because they can't explain things, and so they think a supernatural explanation is an explanation, which it isn't.
Well, by reason, that has reference to the idea that there is a God, and independent of any special revelation, you can look around and, using sound, valid reasoning, conclude that, yes, God does exist. You don't believe that.
No, I believe
that's what
reasoning. I believe reasoning could be used, but it's ignorant reasoning. It's reasoning based on false facts and ignorance. But
right.
it is reason. It's just that it's incorrect reason.
Well,
for example, if a bush moves, you can say that's proof of the supernatural because there's a ghost that move it. That is reason, but it's wrong reason, but it's still reason.
Yeah. For purpose of that question, though, it's talking about there actually being a God and you having a sound, logical, valid argument that reaches that conclusion. Mm-hmm. That's basically what the deist would propose, is that there is a God. He doesn't talk to us or show himself to us, but we can find him anyway.
Okay, I can see that, and I guess, you know, according to the way you're describing it, I would be squarely with the imaginary character,
yeah.
Imagination.
And Campbell rejected reason and imagination and settled on revelation. Owen took up imagination and rejected revelation and reason. Anyway, like you just confirmed, the conclusion of the argument we're trying to build is that man originated the concept of God through imagination. Now, obviously, if he did that, he had to have that ability. And so our minor premise that we need to establish to reach that conclusion is that man was able to originate the idea and concept of God through the power of imagination. Now, given that minor premise and the conclusion, we can construct the major premise, which is, if man was able to do that, and I'm simplifying things a bit here, if man was able to do that, then man did originate the idea of God through the power of imagination. So we have our major premise, minor premise, and conclusion. And the first question we ask is, do you think the argument is so constructed that if its premises are true, then its conclusion will follow as true therefrom, that it's logically valid?
Okay.
Answer, yes.
Well, okay. See, this is where I think it starts getting murky. So to recap, normally in a deductive argument, you have premise, and conclusion, right?
Well, there's all kinds of arguments. This is one of the simplest forms of argument you can find. It's so universally accepted, in my opinion, despite all the flack people try to give me over it, that philosophers and logicians have given it a name, modus ponens.
Right, but I agree with you, and I'm just saying, in summary, it's a premise, conclusion form, correct?
Right.
Okay, so what is the first premise?
The first premise is, if man was able to originate the idea of God through the power of imagination, then man did originate the idea and concept of God through the power of imagination.
Well, that's a faulty premise, because just because
wait a minute,
doesn't mean it must be that way. I mean, that's like saying, if I can make the grass wet by spraying a hose on it, then the grass is wet because I sprayed a hose on it. Well, there's other ways to get the grass wet.
Well, like I said to begin with, when you put it in logical form, even atheists can see the problem with their argument.
Well, the problem there is the premise. That's not a good premise.
I agree with you. But let's back up just a little bit.
Atheists are not claiming that because it's possible that humans invented the idea of God, therefore humans did invent the idea of God. That's not an atheist argument.
That's implied by what they claim, as I just went through. I told you.
No. I don't think so.
Well, that's why you need to take the exercise instead of jump ahead and start arguing against it. The first question is, do you think the argument is logically valid?
That's a different question, because you can
That's question number one.
Hold on, though. Let me just say, I think we both know that you could have a logically valid argument that is nonsense.
That's not an issue here. Everybody would agree that you can have valid arguments that are not sound.
Right. So, I mean, I could agree that the argument is logically valid, which means it follows deductive form,
okay,
and yet still say that the premise is wrong.
Well, I agree with you. I don't agree with either of the premises, but they're not my premises. They're the atheist premises.
No, I don't think so.
Well, let's back up and try it again.
Okay.
The conclusion is, man originated the idea of God through the power of imagination.
Okay, yeah, I'm there with you 100%.
Okay. The minor premise is, he couldn't do that if he didn't have the ability, so the minor premise is, man had the ability to do that.
Of course. Man has the ability to do it.
Okay.
And we're looking at a
modus ponens form. We have the minor premise and conclusion, which you agree to, and now you try to back out of the major premise. Won't work. You're wrong.
You know, you're taking an interesting approach, because what you're doing is you're saying, let's start with the conclusion and then work. Let's work backwards to find out what the premises are before that. Normally, in logic, as I understand it, you start with basic premises and then lead to a conclusion. And then you use that conclusion as your next premise, and you put that together with another premise and build another conclusion. And then you use that conclusion as a premise, so you're building up. So you're doing something kind of strange, I think, by going backwards. I've never heard anybody do that before.
Well, that's good. I'm making history here.
Well,
it's not unusual. I think it may be unusual to the subject, but this is a problem you get into when you try to figure out what people are saying.
Okay, so let me...
You try to take their 400 pages of verbosity, and when you reduce it down to a simple three-line syllogism like I've done here, even you can agree with me there's a problem with the atheist argument.
No, I think there's a problem with what... I think there's a problem with your technique, but...
Wait a minute. You just agreed with my conclusion and the minor premise, and it's a matter of principle, logical principle, that you can take the minor premise and conclusion and formulate the major premise. This argument is implied by what you're claiming in your conclusion.
I'm not saying that because humans could invent God, that therefore they did invent God. That's not.
That's what you're implying.
No. That's not what I'm implying. That's not. You're trying to say, you're trying to work backwards and saying this is the reason why I believe that humans invented the image of God. That's not the reason why I believe the image of God. I can tell you my premises. My premises are exactly because there is no evidence, no good evidence for the existence of God. I could build up because there's no good evidence for, so I would start from the bottom and build up. So number one premise would be, there's no good evidence for the existence of God, therefore it's reasonable to believe that God does not exist. And then we can build up from
that's,
there,
that's
because God does not exist.
That's a different issue.
That's the way I'm building my thought patterns, and you're trying to work backwards into some other ideas.
You just affirmed as a separate issue, which flows from what you were just saying, that you believed man originated the concept of God through imagination.
Yeah, but the reason why is because there's no good evidence for the existence of God. That's the reason why I believe it. That's my basic premise.
You're trying to insert a different premise. That implies this argument. You might not be ready to admit the implications of your own claims, but that's what makes this argument and exercise so important, is when you hear an atheist say, man somewhere just dreamed up God, this is the argument implied, and even you can see it's problematic.
No, I think the problem again is, the problem is that you're stating a bad premise. I would never state that premise as an atheist.
That's why I forced it down your throat, in effect.
It's like you're trying to force a straw man down my throat. I think it's
not
nonsense.
A straw man.
It is.
It's the implication of the claim that somebody just dreamed up God.
I would never make the assertion, and I think you would never make the assertion about anything, that because it's possible, therefore it's true. Nobody would ever make that assertion.
That's what makes this argument so valuable.
That's what makes it so stupid. Because I have a different reason. I have a different premise. Why don't you deal with my real premise? Why do you have to make a different premise that is crazy?
It's not your conclusion is what I'm dealing with.
I know, but I'm telling you, I have a different premise to reach that conclusion. And instead of dealing with my premise, you're trying to throw out some other premise that's nonsense. Of course I'm not going to defend a premise that's nonsense. I have my premise that is better. Why would I go to a stupid premise when I have a good premise?
You didn't give the premises that would lead to this conclusion.
I can give you a premise that leads to that conclusion. I can give you a better one.
Well, there may be more than one argument, but you didn't, as I recall, you didn't give premises that would lead to the conclusion of this argument.
The simple premise is, these are basic premises. There is no good evidence for the existence of God. Therefore, it's not reasonable to believe in the existence of God. Then you can say, basically, why do people believe in God if God doesn't exist? I mean, I don't know the exact wording, but you can lead up from...
That string of statements doesn't make sense.
Why?
You might be able to sit down and write it out better, and I would appreciate you doing that if you think you could actually do it. I'd be glad to evaluate it. But what I try to emphasize is very simple, and I think what happens, this is a critical thinking exercise. It just happens to deal with atheism, and it's the subject matter that causes atheists in particular to rail against the logic involved. The logic I've used to formulate this argument works and can be defended, and I don't think you or anybody else can adequately rebut it.
Well, the logic may work, but the premise is, the premise is stupid, and that's what you're trying to say.
No, it's not stupid. Which premise do you think is stupid?
If you say X is possible, therefore X happened, that is stupid.
Okay, I get that you're saying the major premise is stupid.
Yeah.
But that's the premise implied from your conclusion and the minor premise.
I don't think so.
Then you don't know the logic, which is why this exercise is so important.
How can it be implied when I reject it?
Because you don't understand the implications of your own words, maybe?
No, I do understand the implications. The problem is you're like a blind man trying to figure out what an atheist believes. And so you say, like, okay, well, here's an atheist. He doesn't believe in God. So let's work backwards and try to find out why. I'm saying, look, instead of being a blind man, open your eyes. I'll tell you why I don't believe. We can build up from base principles. Let's build up from the bottom.
Why you don't believe may be independent of this exercise.
No, it isn't. No. Because I don't believe God exists, therefore it logically follows that he has to be from the imagination.
Didn't you say it was from imagination?
Because I'm convinced, or because it's reasonable to believe that God does not exist, therefore God has to be of man's imagination. There's no other alternative. If he doesn't exist, it has to be from the imagination. There's no other way the idea of God can come about.
Okay, I'm trying to think what that has to do with. If I agree that that's one way to support your conclusion about imagination, but it doesn't deal with the more fundamental argument.
The fundamental argument is there's no evidence for the existence of God. No good evidence.
Well, that's what you say. You believe that. I don't have a problem with you believing that. But you have to account for the idea of God, because that's what you're saying. It doesn't exist. So,
what do you mean?
What does it mean? What does it imply when you say someone just dreamed up the idea? It implies that that man had the ability to do so. And
sure.
Since you rule out the other possibilities, your major premise is he had the ability and he did it, which is the major premise. It's not stupid. It's the implications of your own words.
No, I'm saying the stupid format is when you say X is possible, therefore X happened. That's the way you phrased it. Just because something is possible doesn't mean it happened.
Well,
if
you want to change your position to, I think it might have been by imagination, that's fine. I'm dealing with the atheist that says it was unequivocally, unconditionally by imagination. They rule out all the alternatives.
Yeah,
but
why?
In order to take that position,
okay,
you have to...
I agree with you. The atheist says the idea of God came from the imagination. The next question is why? And you're trying to say...
No. You're trying to confuse the issue.
No, the why is the premise.
If you're saying it came from imagination, mm-hmm. Before you talk about the whys and wherefores, man has to have had the ability to do so.
Yeah, that's the why. That's the premise. That's why...
That's not why.
Mm-hmm.
Why had to do with circumstances that allowed him to exercise the ability. But if he did not have the ability, he could not have done it. So that's the first question. That was what Campbell and Owen wrestled about in 1829. Campbell said, you don't have any evidence, speaking of evidence, you don't have any evidence that any man ever dreamed up the notion of God in the beginning.
Why don't we have evidence that humans invented the idea of God? I mean, there's so many different gods. There's so many different varieties.
You can believe that, but you don't have the evidence. You're saying there's no evidence for God?
There's no evidence for the existence of God.
You reject the evidence for God. What you don't have evidence for is that some ancient savage dreamed up the notion in the beginning.
Name me one piece of evidence for the existence of God.
That's another show.
I know. I'm saying there is none. They're logical fallacies.
I think you know very well about the evidence. You just reject it by saying there's not any. Instead of saying there's evidence, I just reject it.
So I'm asking you for evidence, and you can't list one thing?
Well, that's not an argument. It's not a rabbit I chase, because I know the word games that are played. And I've got other hobbies that take up my time, like this exercise.
I mean, like,
But
I think there's lots of evidence for the idea that man made up gods. I mean, one piece of evidence is there's so many different gods. In fact, even in the Christian God, there's so many different Christian gods. There's so many different Christian denominations. Why? Because everybody's making up their own version, and they're calling the other one heretics. How many Protestants and Catholics killed each other?
Atheists like to rely on evidence and make their empirical claims. The fact there are lots of gods doesn't explain where their origination came from. You can't find you didn't originate the idea of God in your own life. You don't know anybody that did, and there's no scientific evidence that'll identify anybody that ever did. It's a philosophical question.
It's based on evidence, though. I would say it's based on evidence. You can build up a logical argument about it. There's so many different... If you look at humanity, you can trace back how even... the people have written books about how the ideas of gods emerged. I mean, going even through polytheism to monotheism.
But they can't find the beginning. They can't find that ancient savage you like to talk about that heard the rustling in the bushes and said, "That's not my brother Tom."
That's because
God.
It was before they learned how to write.
I'm talking about.
Like even in the time,
you can reach beyond your evidence and believe that, and that's one of the points to be made by this argument. Atheists implicitly believe the premises. They go beyond the reach of the evidence. But they are, if you actually work through the six simple questions, they are, this argument is the logical implication of what some atheists claim about imagination being the source.
Okay, let me tell you something where I think you're just going, wayward from the very start. Your whole approach is, like I said, you're starting from a conclusion and you're trying to go backwards and develop premises. I've never seen that done anywhere in philosophy and logic. I've seen just the opposite. They always start from a premise and build a conclusion. So I think your biggest problem might be trying to work backwards.
You probably recognize that as an argument from ignorance. The fact you haven't seen this type of methodology is not particularly significant, except maybe you need to stop and give me six...
Well, can you quote any philosophers?
Six words, yes or no, to the six questions, and then we could take up the details and discuss them.
Well, do you know any philosophers, or can you quote anybody that has used this technique of working backwards from conclusions to building up premises from them?
Have you heard the term enthymeme?
No.
The logic books talk about enthymeme.
Is that what you're doing, your thing?
It's the process of doing just what I've tried to explain.
Okay, so maybe I learned something.
Yeah, and the questions are set up in order to reflect that. And that's why it's a critical thinking exercise to find out, do you not know what a valid argument looks like? Do you not know how these arguments are constructed? Do you not know what atheists say?
No, it could be, I told you, it could be a valid argument, but... Obviously, the premise is...
If
your premise
says
because something could happen, therefore it happened, I mean, that premise is garbage.
It's not garbage, but it's wrong. I agree with you, but you're saying it's wrong for the reason.
You're trying to say, like, look, this is what leads to... This is what atheist thinking leads to, and... I would say, look, I believe that God is a man-made imaginary character, but I have totally different reasons. Why don't you take the reasons I give and deal with my reasons?
You might need to seriously take a look at that. The exercise, again, the six questions, the fact you say maybe is valid tells me You either don't know what a valid argument looks like, or you're playing some kind of game, or it's the atheism content that is getting you not to be committal to what you otherwise would readily admit to, that it's a simple, valid, modus ponens form argument. There shouldn't be any question about that. That's why it's number one.
If we can't agree on
number one, the rest doesn't matter.
Don't we both agree you can have a valid deductive argument with
It's not about whether
let
we
me
can
finish.
have a valid
Let me
argument that's
finish.
not sound.
Let me finish. Do we both agree you can have a valid argument with faulty premises?
Yes, that's not the issue
Okay,
here.
and that's what I think you have. You said, is my argument valid? Is it valid? Is it logically valid? Yes, it could be logically valid, but the premise could still be wrong.
No. See, you're playing this word game again. It's not whether it could be valid and unsound. It's whether it, first, is it valid? We'll talk about whether it's unsound later.
Okay, well, I would agree with you that it, off the top of my head, it could be valid, and I would say it's unsound.
There you go again. It could be valid.
Yeah.
Why can't you give
I'm
me
willing
a
to say
straight
it's
up
I'm willing
yes
to
or
say
no
it,
answer?
no, I'm just saying it's I'd be willing to say it's valid and unsound.
Well, that's question number one. You've just demonstrated why the argument and exercise is so important. You've played around all evening, the last 30 minutes or so, without readily admitting that, yes, this is a valid argument.
Okay,
that's
let's go.
what
Let, okay,
that's
let's go.
what
Let's go. Let's go
that's
forward.
what so many people
Okay,
do.
let's move forward. Let's move forward. Let's move forward and assume I say it's a valid argument. Okay, now what?
Okay. Question number two. Do you think you can take the minor premise and conclusion of a logically valid modus ponens form argument and construct the major premise therefrom?
Yes.
You said you were unfamiliar with the term enthymeme, but that's just what that has reference to.
Yes, I believe you can create a valid conclusion from two premises. I think that's what you just said,
that's
right?
Not, no. I said we've got the conclusion
Mm-hmm.
and we have the minor premise.
Okay.
Do you believe we can take the minor premise and conclusion and build the major premise?
Okay, I'll go forward.
Okay, that's the major premise in the argument.
Okay.
Do you think the major premise of the argument may be properly inferred and properly constructed from the minor premise and conclusion of the argument?
Is that the one about if it's from the imagination, then it is from the imagination?
Well, question number two is whether you can do that generally. Question number three is, in this exercise argument, do you think that the major premise could be properly constructed from the minor premise and conclusion?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, we've done that.
I don't think you've done that though, because I think it's unsound. I think your
that's
premise
not,
is
that's
unsound.
Not, we're not to that issue.
Okay.
This is just the principles of critical thinking going on, logic, the mechanics of logic. Okay. Number four. Do you think there are atheists who implicitly or explicitly believe the conclusion? Well, you've already admitted to
yes.
that. Do you think there are, number five, do you think there's atheists who implicitly or explicitly believe the minor premise? Sure you do.
I can't remember which one the minor and the major premise was.
The minor premise is man was able to do it. Imagine God.
What was the major one?
We'll get to that in a minute. The minor premise is man was able. That's the affirmation of the antecedent, which is modus ponens. The conclusion is man did originate it. So that's five. Number six, do you think there are atheists who implicitly or explicitly believe the major premise? I think they implicitly agree with the major premise. But as you've shown, when you get down to presenting it in this kind of simple, logical, valid, logical, sound, logical presentation, even you can see the problems with it.
I don't think so. I know. I'll tell you very clearly that I think your logic could be valid. I think we both agree. Look. When you have a deductive argument, if it's logically valid, that just means the logic is valid, right? The premise
right.
could
it,
be wrong,
it,
but
it
the
has
but
to
the
do
logic
with
is valid.
Form and not content.
What's that? Form.
Validity has to do with form
right.
and not content.
Right. So we both agree that you could have a logically valid argument for anything, but that just means logically it follows, but you could have a bad premise in that, right?
Right.
Okay, so we both agree in your case that I'm willing to agree. I don't know the details. I can't say 100%, but I think that I could agree with you that the logic, the form is valid. My issue is with the premise, which so that makes the argument unsound, meaning it's not true.
No, it means you have some basic critical thinking skills problems. We can discuss that okay. later if you want.
So anyway, I'll say it again. In summary, I think you have a bad premise. I think if you, what I would do is build up, I would give my premises and build up and say, therefore, God is an imaginary creation. And at the very bottom of the premise is, there is no good evidence for the existence of God. Therefore, it's reasonable to believe God does not exist. That's at the very basic premise. And you say you don't want to argue about the evidence for the existence of God. Well, that's the deal breaker, because that's what it's all about for me.
Well, that's fine. I mean, there's all kinds of flavors and stripes of atheists and theists, both. Everybody's got their pet theories and arguments and willingness to discuss and all that sort of thing. There might be a context in which we might take up some evidentiary things, but my personal opinion is most atheists willing to go public and deny there's any evidence for God typically exhibit their awareness of the evidence. They just reject it.
Okay, well, I don't know what you're talking about, because I need an example, and you don't seem like you're willing to give an example.
Well, I'll give you an example.
Okay.
Joe Smith, yesterday, my next-door neighbor, had a vision from God, and he'll testify to that.
So what?
You accept that as evidence, his testimony?
I would have to talk to him directly, for one thing, because
I'm not asking whether you're going to believe him. Are you going to accept testimony as evidence in dealing with that issue?
I'm open-minded. I'd have to ask him all kinds of questions. Exactly what did this God say, and to see how it worked out. I would have to check it into it. I'm predisposed because of my previous learning that he's deluded, but I'm open to find out how did this God appear, what did he say, etc. I mean, there's a lot of questions I would have to ask.
Well, that's the sort of thing that goes to that issue, is evidence is presented, and you're going to say, that's not evidence because I don't like it.
No, I'm telling you, though, I would listen to it to find out what it is. I mean, I'm open.
I think from my personal life experience, you've come in contact with a lot of evidence, and you've looked at it and examined it and rejected it. Not that it's not there, you've just rejected it. That's fine.
Because
but
I think
that's different than saying there is no evidence.
I've rejected it because
Kent Hovind and Ken Ham saying there's no evidence for evolution.
We have both rejected divine revelation. You reject the divine revelation from the Mormons and from the Muslims and all
right.
that.
Right.
So why do you reject it? Well, because it makes sense to you.
Well, what I'm getting at is it gets confusing to try and differentiate between the idea that there is no evidence. Ken Ham says there's no evidence for evolution. It's not that there's no evidence. It's that he rejects the evidence that there is.
Right.
The same goes for the existence of God.
No, it's not.
Atheists keep asking for evidence, and they reject the evidence that they know exists.
It's not the same at all, because if I was talking to Ken Ham, he would say there's no evidence. I'd say, okay, let's look at the evidence. Let's look at DNA. Let's look at the DNA code across organisms, for example. If somebody says God revealed themselves to me, it would be the same thing. Let's talk about the details. If they're going to say it happened when they're on an acid trip or on drug high or fasting for 30 days and hadn't had anything to drink,
The nature of the evidence is going to be different in each case by necessity, I suppose. But it's evidence nonetheless that we can evaluate, accept, or reject.
Right.
And, like you were alluding to earlier, the only difference between me and thee is one God. I've rejected all the others. You've rejected even mine. So there's not that much difference between us. But I don't see a particular value in trying to engage on the basis that you're saying there's no evidence, as opposed to saying I've looked at the evidence and decided not to believe it.
Okay. Well, we're out of time for today. They're ready to kick us out of the studio.
Oh. Yeah, I thought we might be running over.
Okay, so thanks again for calling in, and hopefully we'll have some interesting YouTube comments to deal with.
Okay, appreciate the time.
All right.
Hope I didn't get too excited.
Okay.